Okay. I'm here at Stone Free with rising stars, Stone Broken. Guys, introduce yourselves.
I'm Rich.
I'm Chris.
I'm Robin.
And I'm Kieran.
Now, you're the man under the headliner at Indigo 02 today, yeah. Under Orange Goblin and above the legendary Warrior Soul. So it must be great to see your progress moving up the bill, doing headline shows in London now. How does that feel?
It's awesome. It's been a pretty cool journey, to be fair.
Definitely,
yeah. You know, sort of going from being the support band that, you know, gets a lot of good support to then being able to move into headline territory. I mean, our first ever headline show in London was at the Black Heart in Camden, which, you know, it's quite an intimate venue.
Great venue.
We managed to sell it out every single time that we played it. But then, I mean, the last headline show we played was the Islington Assembly Hall, which is incredible. And now we're playing the Indigo stage at the O2, which is insane. So it's, you know, we're proud of what we've been able to achieve so far. And we just hope that we can carry on going.
You guys have a new album out, your second with Spine Farm. Tell us about that.
Yeah, it came out in March. It came about just after we came off the road with Glenn Hughes, didn't it? Mm-hmm. We wrote it.
Not so shabby.
No. See, we were very inspired then. You know, after spending sort of 6 or 7 weeks on the road, going around Europe, and it all came together within 6 weeks, and then just a further 3 weeks to record the album. And since then, we've been working hard to get it out to, obviously, the UK. The UK had a really good reception when it came out, and the campaign for the rest of the world is still ongoing. We're still working hard at it.
It's Ain't Always Easy is what it's called, and yeah. I believe it charted nationally.
It did. It was a top 40 in the national charts, which was
incredible. Blew our
minds. Yeah, yeah.
It was.
We were all having bets to see where it would come, and none of us imagined that. It was just insane.
Yeah, I mean, even management were quite surprised. You know, I mean, they obviously had high hopes for it, and in the back of their minds, they really wanted it to be a top 40. But they said, realistically, with all the other releases that are out at the same time, you know, we could be looking at a top 50, maybe. And we managed to get top 40, which was incredible. And we were number 2 in the rock charts.
Brilliant.
Which, again, blew our minds.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's been pretty cool.
You guys are from Walsall. How did you find each other?
Well, me and Robin had been in bands together for quite some time, mm-hmm. before Stone Broken was even a thought. It was kind of off the back of having a couple of years out, wasn't it? We decided that we wanted to give it one more try.
Thank goodness.
Yeah. we got a rehearsal space just for me and Robin at the time, just so we could make some noise and see what would happen. And then it all happened quite quickly. Within a month of having this rehearsal space, we managed to find Kieran through Robin's dad, actually, who was a customer at the bar that he worked at. Yeah. And he was behind the bar, and Robin's dad approached because someone had tipped him off saying that he was a bass player. So he goes up, he doesn't order a drink, he just says, "You're a bass player."
And then starts taking my picture.
Yeah, he comes back home. And he goes to Robin, what do you think of this guy here? I'm thinking, hold on. Hold on. What's going on? He said, no, he's a bass player. So we got his email and we started emailing back and forth. And he was interested. And he came and we jammed and we gelled straight away. And in the previous band that Kieran was in, there was a guitarist called Chris.
Right.
And he saw him at a Tremonti gig a couple months into us jamming, and he said to Chris, I've got a new project, you fancy? And Chris was like, oh, really? Not another band?
I was at the level where I was thinking, I'm going to stop the band stuff, because I've been in a few bands, none of them worked out, egos got in the way and everything, so I thought, I'm going to just knock it on the head, I'm going to be a bedroom guitarist. Then Kieran comes up to me and says, I've got a new band.
Not again.
I don't think I'm ready for this.
But you don't strike me as a band with any issues like that at all.
No.
Well, I said to Kieran, I said, I'll come and help you guys out at the start, and then I've just not left.
Then 5 years later.
We still have to.
previously I met these guys and I'm like, oh, I think these guys are, you know, they've got the good attitude and everything. I think we're going to go far. So.
Sure. Now, the Black Country has a massive reputation for rock, the birthplace of heavy metal, Judas Priest, Black Sabbath. But your guys' music, particularly the first album, I think, reminded me of the arena, the Canadian arena stadium band, Nickelback.
Right.
You must get that a lot. What do you think of that?
We do get that comparison drawn quite a lot, to be fair. And like you say, especially the first album, because when a lot of people discover us, it's via YouTube, and our first ever track is the one that comes up first of all. And I mean, we're always going to be compared to someone, because whenever you listen to a new band, you try and make that association already. And I think the mixture of like riffs and a rough voice and catchy choruses, you know, I
guess. Also a mature sound, I think. I mean, beyond your years, unless you're all...
In the first year, we worked really hard to get our sound properly and to something that we felt was like a good gig.
Yeah, we didn't want to rush into anything, basically. So we set aside more time than I actually thought that we all planned to really refine what we did and make sure that we had songs, you know, not just music, and what we wanted, actual songs that people would be able to sing along to. And to be fair, we all love listening to that kind of music. So I always say to people, when you write a song, you're committing to playing that song live for the rest of your life.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got to really enjoy what you do.
Yeah.
You know, because I mean, if you write a song that connects with your fans, you're expected to play that every live show that you... I mean, Wait For You, that's kind of a song that everyone... At a headline shows, if we didn't play Wait For You, there would be uproar.
Yeah,
because that's kind of the spectacle of the set. In support shows, you know, we've got a restricted amount of time and that sort of thing. But I think that's the kind of the attitude that you've got to have, is you've got to love every single thing that you put on record and release. So we wanted to make sure that we got it right the first time round, and we didn't have to release another album to then try and get it right, and another one to then, you know. So we wanted to just spend that time at the start, so we could hit the ground running. So that's
absolutely
what we did.
And I do agree with you. I think your material is very immediate live, and so it's easy to like straight away. So I mean, that's brilliant. You know, who's writing the songs?
A lot of it is me, and then the guys will come and add their parts in and tweak things. You know, but I think the most important thing is that we all agree on the songs at the end. If there's a part, I mean, at first Kieran didn't like Wait For You. When I first showed him the acoustic part, he was like, I'm not feeling it, man. I was like, please, just hold on until it's almost done. And then he turned around and said, okay, it's a good song in the end. So it's give and take, I think.
Yeah.
You know, and we've all got that kind of attitude where, you know, if it works, it works. If it doesn't, it doesn't. And if I was to write something that just didn't fit or didn't feel like a good song, then the guys would tell me.
You did it.
Yeah, and we'd sit down and work it out together. So.
Mm-hmm. You guys seem on the point of going global. Certainly you seem to be spending more time abroad.
Yeah, yeah.
It's awesome. We're spending so much time on planes now.
Yeah. Though,
like this.
But, praying that our luggage gets
there. Yeah. Oh, you're at the hands of the luggage handlers, and every single time your guitar goes up that conveyor belt and down the other end, I'm like, oh, come on. Please, meet me the other end.
And you're playing Download Paris soon, same bill as Ozzy and Guns N' Roses.
Yeah, we're playing tomorrow, actually.
Tomorrow?
Yeah, which is going to be
right.
Awesome. It does mean, though, that we've got 7 hours of driving tonight.
Yeah, to get there. You can't stick around too long as well.
Yeah, but it's great, you know. I mean, we played Donington last year, and this year we're playing Download Paris, which is, again, a great, you know, festival to be a part of. And I think it's kind of testament to what we've been able to achieve with our team outside of the UK.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've got a great agent who can sort of swing these deals for us, and we've got a good promo team over in France as well.
Yeah.
And we're just grateful of the opportunity, I guess, and we're just going to go over there and we're going to try and smash it out of the park.
Yeah. So you guys ready to spend the rest of your lives abroad on tour, if necessary?
Yeah, that's
the plan. And in the UK,
well,
of course. Yeah.
I'm looking at places in America as we speak.
Well, I was just going to say, your lyrics seem to be about, you know, self-belief and fulfilling potential and things like that. So sky's the limit. Why not?
That is the mentality behind it, isn't it? If you can think positively about it, then there's more chances of it happening.
Sure. You guys got noticed very quickly after your self-financed debut album. Mm-hmm. What do you think was the X factor that you had, apart from your girl drummer? Of course.
You know what? It could be a couple of things. For one, I think our songs are quite sort of radio ready.
Yeah.
But then also, especially with record labels and management, you need to show that you're a hard-working band already, because although they will take on some of the work for you, you've still got to have that work ethic, and our work ethic is strong. We take everything head on, and we get our hands dirty, and we've never really shied away from that. And I think, and especially with conversations that we've had with labels, is that always comes across. You know, you guys put the time in, and if you can put the time in, you can put the money in, then we'll be prepared to invest as well, because they're not just investing in the music, they're investing in the people. So I think that's probably one thing that made us stand out a bit, is we've always strived to always be doing something and working towards the next thing. So it's just great that we've now got someone steering it properly. You know, we've always been the engine behind the band, but to have someone who can direct the best route is a great thing to have, and it makes what we do release more potential, I think.
Mm-hmm. And you have people coming a long way to your shows, guys coming from the Americas and things. The Broken Army.
It's great. Yeah, I mean, the Broken Army, it is literally what it says on the tin, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's an army of fans, and they the camaraderie and how close they all are is just incredible. I mean, to be able to have that alone is worth doing all of this.
Yeah.
And like you say, we've had people travel over from the States to come and see us. We've got some more people coming over from the States this year to come and see us, and we're going over to the States to see them. So it's going to be
Awesome.
Yeah, it's going to be cool. Like, we've had a couple of shows in Spain recently, and there was this one guy in particular who had been waiting for ages to come and see us play live, and we managed to meet up with him before the show, and just to see his reaction when we, you know, gave him a bit of time to, you know, just...
It means a lot.
Yeah.
And, you know, engagement is very... And you're good at engagement of the crowd as well.
Yeah.
You have to engage with each other and engage with the crowd on stage. Yeah. And I think you're really good at that. You guys may well become role models for young people. I know that you lost somebody through addiction.
Yeah.
I mean, that's quite a sobering thought. Mm-hmm. And it reflects in the lyrics of your songs as well.
Yeah. I mean, we try and write about life experiences. And then also, we try and put a positive spin on the whole thing. So so we can almost offer encouragement in a song, if that makes sense. And we've had quite a few people come back to us and say, you know, this song really helped me through this part, or I can relate to this song. And like you say, it's all about having that connection. And if you can have that connection in all parts of being in the band, like through the songs, when you're playing live, and then when you're speaking to fans after the show, social media, we try and keep ourselves connected all of the time. And although sometimes it can be difficult to keep up with that, especially with the social media side, it's a 24/7 kind of thing. And now that we're sort of venturing out into new territories, they're all on different time zones. So,
different languages.
Yeah, you wake up and there's about five messages that were sent at like 4 o'clock in the morning. You're like, oh god. But that's the crazy thing about it is that you get to have that and share that with loads and loads of people. So.
Okay, guys. So best of luck this afternoon and best of luck at Download Paris.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.